Welcome to This Jungian Life. Three good friends and Jungian analysts, Lisa Marciano, Deborah Stewart, and Joseph Lee, invite you to join them for an intimate and honest conversation that brings a psychological perspective to important issues of the day.
I'm Lisa Marciano, and I'm a Jungian analyst in Philadelphia.
I'm Joseph Lee, and I'm a Jungian analyst in Virginia Beach, Virginia.
I'm Deborah Stewart, a Jungian analyst on Cape Cod.
Today we're going to toss out a topic on psychological dismemberment. And this is a kind of a broad net. We were mulling this over before we began, and there's ideas that we're pulling in around a very complicated psychological concept called attacks on linking. We're reaching into some literature around psychological dismemberment. We're reaching towards trauma, and we're trying to hammer together a deeper, comprehensive meaning around psychological dismemberment, and we're inviting you into that discussion.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, this is not a light topic.
Not at all.
But I think when we started off, I was thinking about just these everyday, ordinary ways that we kind of become uncoupled from our sense of ourselves or from a sense of a connection with an other. So it sounds super dramatic, psychological dismemberment, but I think we all are in that space like every day. I mean, sort of maybe numbing out, scrolling through Instagram can be a way of becoming psychologically dismembered.
Yeah, we call it checking out. And I'm thinking the normal framework for this is that according to Jung, the psyche is dissociable. And I think of it like a whole group of like bubbles where everything is connected but separate, and some bubbles are kind of interlocked with other bubbles. And so we can switch from different parts of ourselves to other parts of ourselves. And it's necessary. It's how we're organized. We can't pay attention to everything all the time. So we're constantly shifting attention, and some parts of us are turned on and some parts of us are turned off.
So, Deb, you're kind of normalizing it as just a shift of focus between internal and external objects, whether you're over-focused on the phone and therefore you're not paying attention to your mom at the dinner table and she feels, you know, the distance, because you have no attention on the immediate person. So that's just talking about just a kind of fluidity that human beings have. Mm-hmm. But when we're talking about psychological dismemberment, I think we're talking about something that's a little more painful, more disturbing, and a little less in the realm of kind of just an average normal moment.
I agree. I think I wanted to build on Lisa's point that it's very human and part of life. And that it's kind of at one end of the spectrum. And then at the other end of the spectrum, I think we have, you know, really traumatic, difficult, painful experiences mm-hmm. that have to be cut off or dismembered.
Right. So sometimes this numbing out experience can be something that we can easily resolve by somebody just, you know, calling our attention back to what's happening in the room. But what happens when the numbing out doesn't go away? Or that perhaps your spouse mm-hmm. or your therapist or analyst notices this numbing phenomena, and we can't just decide it away. And we discover that there really is this pattern or phenomena of fragmentation or incoherence of ideas that is really has become a noticeable struggle.
Yeah, I mean, I can just give a kind of generic example from something that I know it's happened to me, and I've also seen it happen to people that I'm working with, where maybe there's a kind of difficult reality that needs to be accepted. And there's this kind of flight into fantasy. It might last just for a few hours, or sometimes it can last for weeks or months, where there's a building up of images and imagination in the unconscious about the new relationship, for example, that the person's going to pursue. And it has a slightly over-energized quality to it, this fantasy. And then when you sort of dig into it, it's like, well, really what's going on is you're fleeing from the reality in front of you, for example, that your marriage is sometimes painful.
So that has a kind of schizoid quality to mm-hmm. it, where the outer world has become so painful, or perhaps was very painful in early childhood, and the brain and the psyche realizes that we can make a rapid and long-term retreat into an inner place. And that can become so habitual that we use that frequently as a way of coping with distress in the adult life. Mm-hmm. And it has some serious consequences.
So we have cut off feelings that are too painful to experience, and instead have a fantasy perhaps that, you know, everything's coming up roses, or it will be coming up roses, mm-hmm. and that we defend against and cut off those feelings that are too unbearable mm-hmm. to face.
And I want to say that we don't do that, because when we say we do it, it sounds almost like a decision. But I think that there's kind of a mechanism mm-hmm. in the atmosphere that makes this happen. And we feel like we're just being swept along a river mm-hmm. and there we are mm-hmm. not feeling anything or unable to feel something. And we don't feel that we are choosing it, actually.
That's mm-hmm. such a good point, that it's like the when a fuse blows in your home, that the system has become overloaded, and then the fuse box just trips the switch, and you know, the lights in that part of the house just go off. It just happens.
Yeah. And what that reminds me of is the work of our colleague, Donald Kalsched, whose work we've referenced before on the podcast. His book, The Inner World of Trauma, is an amazing book. It kind of reconfigured our understanding of trauma. And one of the things that Don talks about is that there are these archetypal defenses that when we've been traumatized in childhood, these archetypal defenses get awakened. And in an effort to protect us from becoming hurt again, when there is connection, say with another person, with an analyst or a loved one, this archetypal defense comes along and quite violently cuts that off. And what Don noticed as he worked with patients with trauma is that this would manifest as images and dreams, say, of a crazy person with an axe busting through. And it's this idea that you know, talk about the light switch, you know, I'm gonna stop this right now because I don't want you to get hurt again.
Mm-hmm. And what stopped might be a growing sense of intimacy with the other person.
Vulnerability.
Or even vulnerability, a sense of love.
Trust.
Even things that are quite positive in the ordinary sense, still in the atmosphere, feels very, very dangerous and is disallowed, despite the fact that on a conscious level, the person is aching to mm-hmm. have those kinds of experiences.
Mm-hmm. Don calls it the persecutor-protector or protector-persecutor complex. And that because of some early relational and usually sustained trauma, that the inner world, the archetypal world, comes up with a protector who can sequester the inviolable soul of the person that cannot be destroyed, and hide it away in a safe place. But that later on, you know, all that part of the psyche knows is it's dangerous to show yourself. It's dangerous to come out of where I have hidden you away to be safe. And so later in life, it makes it very difficult for the person to trust, to be vulnerable, to engage in certain kinds of emotional connections, because that inner protector then becomes a persecutor and says, don't come out. That world is dangerous. Relationships are not a good idea. Intimacy isn't safe. So usually comes up the persecutorial part of this comes up when the person wants to stretch into something new, taking the risk, let's say, to take a new job or fall in love or you know, a number of other things. And that is a kind of wonderful image of a cut off, a part that has had to be sequestered and cut off from consciousness.
And a fairy tale image of this that Don actually uses in his book is Rapunzel. You know, Rapunzel is taken into the tower as a baby, and she's, you know, kept there by the witch, who both sequesters her away from the world and also cares for her. And at some point, obviously, there's a crisis in the story where Rapunzel needs to break out of that tower. But that's the kind of sense of it.
Yeah, that's a great illustration of this.
There's also a novel by Neil Gaiman called The Graveyard Book. Deb just had a big smile.
That's because it's a vampire book, and listeners may know about my romances with vampires.
Yes, Silas, the vampire. But it starts off with this horrible scene of trauma where the whole family is killed and just this toddler survives. And he toddles into the graveyard, and the denizens of the graveyard, the ghosts, keep him and protect him. And for me, this is another similar image to what Don is talking about how the inviolable soul goes away and is kind of nurtured in the inner world, which is, you know, an adaptive response, but eventually it becomes constraining and keeps us out of life.
So in the clinical environment, when the trauma or the catastrophic event happens in the lifespan, can really change the clinical picture. And often, the younger a person is when the catastrophe happens, the more foundational the fragmentation is. And the longer the analysis is, the more difficult the process is. So sometimes the catastrophic events happen in early infancy, so that there are no concrete memories. There are just feeling tones of distress or even agony that are kind of floating in the psyche. There was a wonderful book by Margaret Little called Psychotic Anxieties. It's actually a journal entry of her own analysis and dropping down into this agonizing field of force. So one theory about this, which is interesting to think about in terms of framing it, is that when we're very, very young infants, all of our emotions are kind of exploding all over the place. The full range. We feel love, we feel hate, we feel frightened, we feel close. And that at a certain point, the child begins to project their emotions onto the mother or the primary caregiver. And this process of, let's say, making the mother the bad one, so that the infant can be good and loving, actually allows the infant to develop a sense of coherence in the personality and even a belief. And this is very, very early when this happens, a belief that they are in fact good, which allows this kind of linking together of memories and experiences and creates an identity. But if for some reason these primal, dangerous feelings are not projected out, but they stay inside the developing infant, there's a kind of malicious environment that grows up with the person, and they find that it is very, very difficult to escape. And how that might show up in the consulting room is people that never have a sense of what they should be doing or where they should be going or even what might make them happy. And they've never felt happy, and they don't know why they feel happy. And they often just don't like anything or don't like anyone or even feel an underlying hostility towards most people and a resentment if they get close. So this spirit of bad, negative emotion is woven into the matrix of the personality. And ooh, that is something to work with.
Yeah. And I think it can sort of show up in a person's life in terms of lots of broken relationships. Like it's very difficult for them to tolerate, for example, getting close to someone. And so it could be that when that starts to happen, they do something to sabotage it or they move away or whatever. But it can also kind of show up in the fine-grained day-to-day interactions. I mean, sometimes, you know, when you're sitting with someone in the consulting room, you're hopefully very attuned to the quality of relatedness between you. There can be a field that arises that feels very connected, where both the analyst and analysand can drop into a shared reverie. And there can be times when it just feels like the person is sort of across a chasm and there's no resonance between the person's nervous system and yours. And what this might look like is, say, someone who just comes in and just sort of a wall of words, just one sort of story after another, staying right on the surface, never dropping down, never slowing down. And it can make you sort of feel like, gosh, am I even in the room? You know, that's the way it might feel to someone.
A determination to sort of just stay on the surface, mm-hmm. with, you know, this is what happened to me today and then last week. And then on the other hand.
Well, and to defend against connection through almost over talking.
Yes, it's a defense to keep people out. And I'm aware of what we're calling today's episode of psychological dismemberment and what gets cut off, which is exactly what happens in dismemberment, that there is a psychological, you know, finger or hand or limb mm-hmm. that has been cut off that is about feelings. Feelings that the person simply does not have access yes. to. They have been cut off and banned and relegated to some kind of psychological limbo.
Yeah, to the basement or something. I mean, I think that you said a hand or a finger. I think it's usually the head. I think when we're being dismembered in this way, it's often a profound disconnection between our thinking and our embodied feeling, and it can really feel like we're just a talking head, like we're mm-hmm. stuck in our head. So we're also talking about this disconnection between, you know, parts of ourselves, right?
There's a model for that called the Basque model, B-A-S-K, and it's what gets cut off is behavior can get cut off of certain kinds of things that I never, ever do, places that I do not go in the outer world. I don't go to scary movies. I don't eat red meat, you know, for example, of behavioral restrictions. The A is affect. Feelings get cut off. Oh, I didn't mind. No, I didn't feel anything about that. It was fine. Sensation, the connection with our body, can also get cut off. And sometimes feelings can be relegated to the somatic realm, where we have headaches or stomach aches or something like that. And it's just a physical ailment. And then the K is knowledge that lapses in memory. I just don't remember anything about that. I think, you know, everything was always pretty much okay. And sometimes people will come in to analysis and say, you know, I had there wasn't anything out of the ordinary in my childhood. We had a really very nice home and two caring parents. And only later do some other memories get retrieved or emerge that are allowed to emerge into consciousness. And it's a helpful little acronym for me of how we can dismember experiences that are too intense to be absorbed into consciousness. They cannot be admitted into the conscious realm because they're dangerous.
And the hopeful but dangerous process is the things that are cut off are still in there somewhere. And they're spinning around and they're having, again, a kind of atmospheric
yes.
influence. For instance, this atmosphere in the body of I never feel good. This atmosphere with people that I just don't like anybody. And we don't know why.
Yes.
But these centers in the unconscious of cut off things still kind of thrum and affect us in very subtle and pernicious yes. ways.
And that's the problem, and that's why a solution of psychotherapy or there are other pathways too, I guess, is so important, is that those things are still there running your life from underneath, like the hard drive of your computer, but they're in the unconscious and they take your energy away from your life.
And so we need to remember them.
Aha. Mm-hmm.
And kind of come back into connection with these things.
And yes. that's often happens with the analyst in interpreting, that the analyst does their best to remember what's been said and experienced and is able to create links.
Mm-hmm.
You know, oh, well, you were feeling really, and some of them can be simple. You're feeling really bad today. Do you remember you had that really distressing phone call,
mm-hmm.
you know, with your cousin mm-hmm. the day before? And those two things could be linked. Two objects are linking together. Mm-hmm. If somebody is really, if the system is really not allowing things to remember, they'll just say, "Oh no, that's not it. That's not it."
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But if it's allowed in a sense, sometimes it can come together, and people say, "Oh, oh," and there's this incredible relief that how they're feeling and what happened actually are related to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I know that sounds simple to those of you that,
no,
that don't experience
really
that disconnect,
yeah.
but for people that are really fragmented or dismembered, that can be a kind of revelation. Mm-hmm.
The remembering is it takes time and intention, the same way that it takes time and intention to reattach mm-hmm. A part of the body that might have been cut off. You can remember a finger or even an arm, I think, these days. And it is a difficult, painful process. Mm-hmm. But I like your image. That's what we do, is mm-hmm. remember.
Yeah, and Joseph, that's such a great point about kind of helping our analysands kind of make links between, mm-hmm. between say, what happened, what they thought about it, and then how that made them feel. And once you can do that more, you start to get a sense of yourself, a more coherent, varied, nuanced sense of yourself as a person moving through the world. You know, this kind of fluid, changing thoughts, changing feelings, but you can track it all and you feel more consolidated.
And one of the impulses that can come from the self is the creation of symbols. That the word symbol is Greek. Syn, S-Y-N, means together, and balo means to put or to throw. So the word symbol means to throw things together. So often, if a dream can be remembered, or even a fantasy can be remembered, that the images that the unconscious is making and the narratives that it makes in the dreams is trying to put things together that have a hard time staying together related to the conscious world.
Yeah, that's really nice. And I think, you know, why it's important to relate to psychological content symbolically, because it's, you know, the self or the unconscious trying to show us something, trying to knit something together. But it's not always obvious what's going on, right? We have to be curious about it and try to feel into it, understand the message.
One of the most difficult times, I think, in analysis for me is when the indwelling spirit that is disallowing it carries a tremendous amount of hatred, which can happen. And what will occur in the analysis is that I will receive a tremendous amount of hatred in the room as I'm trying to help them symbolize, to put things together. And there is a kind of battle, you know, just kind of like Lord of the Rings. There's this battle going on in the room between Gandalf and the Balrog, you know, trying to see.
Let me guess, you're Gandalf.
I'll leave. It depends. To some clients, I look like the Balrog. That's the problem. Because to that field that breaks things apart very maliciously, the attempt to put things together just will not be allowed. And it can feel like a battle that one has to survive.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm really picking up on your point about how aggressive and violent that dismembering energy in the psyche is. It takes energy to cut off behavior, feeling, sensation, or knowledge, to dismember some part of ourselves. And there's an image in an alchemical book, and all these references will be in the show notes, called Transformation of the Psyche, which is an exegesis of a lot of alchemical symbols. It's called the Golden Head, and in the image itself is this image, great, of violence, where this man with hair that's sort of streaming out behind him is wielding a huge, really oversized sword, and on the ground is a very blanched corpse where all the limbs have been cut off, and this man holding this sword in one hand is holding a head in the other. And it's kind of shocking to think that that kind of thing can happen in the psyche. And as a personal story here, when I was studying for the exams in our Jungian training, we had to pick an alchemical image. And there was something about this image that was really fascinating for me. There was something uncanny and horrifying and yet compelling for me. So I very unstrategically chose this alarming image to bring to my oral exam. And when I was asked about it, I promptly froze and could not discuss it, even though I had written 25 or 30 pages with all kinds of examples and mythology and fairy tales. because there was something so deep in my own psyche that had cut off my intellectual or mental conscious access to this horrifying image. And it would take me more time to really be able to get down into the feeling that I had cut off in myself about how scary and horrifying and incredibly sad this image was, what it resonated for me inside at a deep feeling level.
And so that's a powerful, heartbreaking example of the potency of certain archetypal images to actually gather together certain aspects of the psyche and invite them to relate to each other, and even to look at these alchemical images, and the particular one of the severed head is to really try to achieve an objective view of the dismembering process, which, by the way, doesn't want to be seen because it's a defense. And then the uprushing of really painful feeling that happens as the symbol begins to work on us, which in the beginning doesn't feel like a blessing, you know, not at all. It is painful.
Needless to say, I failed the exam. And I'm also kind of looping back to Lisa's point that what often gets dismembered is the head. Is I thought I could think my way through this.
Right.
And like so many other things in therapy, you know, if you could think your way through it, it would have been done without coming into therapy.
So we're partially talking here about a disconnection between thoughts or conscious things we consciously know and the feelings that are associated with them. You know, another example of how this happens sometimes in the consulting room is I remember working with someone who we'd been working together for a little while. And then one day she brought in this very hot content about some childhood sexual abuse. And, you know, I knew clearly that, that this was really important and that we were, you know, right in this kind of serious territory. And we worked on it, and I felt really present and I felt really there. And then later, I guess I went to write the note or something, and I could not remember what we talked about. And it was, I mean, I understood it at the time as a field phenomenon because, you know, trust me, I don't forget content like that, you know, but this content for her had a way of sort of disappearing from her mind. I mean, not that she ever sort of just factually forgot her basic biography, but in a feeling way of being connected with it in a feeling way, she often wasn't. So it sort of emerged and then it submerged. And this was kind of an image of sort of an attack, you know, an inability to stay connected to the content in an emotional way.
Yeah,
for both of us.
Disallowed.
Yeah.
But it also brings up a really interesting phenomena that as analysts, we are really trying to drop down into the feeling, into the energy that's happening in the client, that's being brought forward. And we're using our own psyches as a kind of diagnostic tool. So if we're really focused on the client with a lot of curiosity and empathy, and the client begins to go into a certain state, we can temporarily be entrained into some of these states, which is often surprising and incredibly instructive. So I too have been in sessions where all of a sudden I'm sitting across the room and it feels like a blizzard is in the room and I can't see the other person and I can't think. And the other person might not be saying or doing anything, but that gives me enormous information like, wow, that we're dealing with this kind of fragmenting problem. And I am getting some resonance of what that's like.
Yeah, and we know that it's really coming up from the unconscious because it presents like that, right? This is not something the person's consciously aware of.
And that's important because we want to develop an objective feeling about it. It's no one's fault that there is a kind of atmosphere in the psyche, but they have to somehow take hold of it or believe that there's something to be done. Now, one of the really tricky problems with dismemberment and fragmentation is that there is often a poverty of curiosity in people who suffer from this. And the lack of curiosity about the soul, curiosity about the psyche, is probably the most effective, pernicious defense against solving any of this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just not curious about it. I'm suffering it, but I'm not really curious mm-hmm. about looking inside.
Mm-hmm.
So that people don't come into therapy, they don't talk to their friends. These painful outcomes happen over and over again, and they're just not curious about what's going on inside of them.
And there's a real denial, too, of that. Oftentimes I've had, thinking of someone that I had quite a while back, who had a lot of very vivid dreams about her mother, and always in sort of an anxious mode or a negative aspect, or there was always a conflict and so on. But whenever I brought up that there might be feelings other than joy, kindness, appreciation, and closeness with this parent, is simply human. We all have a lot of feelings about our mother or father. There would be a vociferous, no, that's not true. That's what therapists do. They always bring up other stuff like this. There was a real wall of that forbade any conscious awareness of multiple feelings about the parent, and absolutely no aggressive or angry feelings were admitted into consciousness for quite a long time.
So that's really interesting. So she was disconnected. She was dismembered from this awareness.
And dismembered from her own.
Yes. And also from you. It was it went kind of both directions, right?
Yes.
And so the aggression that she was unaware of also hit you, right? Because it sounds like she came at you pretty strong with this.
Yes. Isn't that, you're really illustrating how this can get played out in the relational field, that the feelings that were not allowed in her by psyche got projected onto me as if I were the attacking person in the room.
Mm-hmm.
Which in some sense I was, because I was lifting up for consideration things that had to be violently cut off by her psychically, or by psyche in her, I should say.
And this goes to this category called working through the transference, which in early analysis and Freudian analysis was considered the gold of the session. That if people could work through their transferences, then their analysis was at a conclusion. As Jungians, we have higher goals of individuation and other things. But when the transference shows up, then you know you're kind of hitting pay dirt.
Mm-hmm.
Although it can be really tricky and even uncomfortable for the analyst to kind of dance with this.
Yeah.
Yes, and it was an opportunity first for me to have something in my awareness. And then to have between us an opportunity to hold the tension here of how do we deal with this in the room between two people, of things that are that you dislike, and we can sit here together with the fact that what I'm bringing to your attention is something that arouses a lot of aggression, anger, and hostility in you. So here we are. We're going to just talk about it for a minute.
You know, I really like that, Deb, that you brought up that idea about holding the tension, because I think in a way when we're cutting off either another person or ourselves, sort of by definition, right, we're not holding the tension. And Jung talked a lot about the need to hold the tension of the opposites, and that when you can do that, something can shift powerfully. So it's a real sort of either or, black and white kind of feeling when we're in a sort of cut off kind of place. This is all bad, or this is all good, or I can't talk to you anymore, or I need to not know about that. There's a kind of ruthlessness to it.
There's internal and external splitting,
Yeah, a kind of all or nothing construct. And I think I also want to just highlight that this kind of repair has to happen in the interpersonal realm first, before it can really get reconnected intrapsychically or internally in the person. There, it has to be able to be these feelings that had to be cut off have to be found tolerable and acceptable to another person first. And then it can be knitted back together, or that's the process of knitting it back together internally. So it's both interpersonal, intrapsychic. It's a dance.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to just play around here with a fairy tale for a second. Mm. It's a Grimm's tale called The King of the Golden Mountain. And it's a really interesting tale. And I'm not going to be able to do it full justice here because it's long and it has a lot of motifs in it. But it starts off in a very similar way to The Handless Maiden, which is also a tale of dismemberment, mm-hmm. right? Because her hands get cut off, if you know that tale. That there's a poor merchant. He's wandering in the forest. He has no money. A little black dwarf comes up to him and says, you know, I'll give you lots of money if you give me the first thing that rubs against your leg when you go home. And he thinks it's going to be the cat. And of course, it's his son.
Mm.
So when the son turns 12, the little dwarf shows up and says, now you need to give him to me. But the son is very valiant, and they come up with a way to avoid having to do that. And instead, the boy gets in a boat and drifts down the river. So there's this kind of cutoff from the parents. And by the way, the tale starts with this essential wound by the parent where the child has been profoundly betrayed by the parent.
Mm-hmm.
So he eventually comes to this castle, and I'm leaving out lots of details, but there's a snake who's actually a princess, and she instructs him on how to rescue her, that he's going to have to be beset by these kind of monstrous men for 3 nights in a row. And on the last night, they're going to cut off his head. And they do. And she uses some magical water to heal him. And then they're married and they're having a great life. Then he wants to go home and show his father. And it's now been many years and he has a son of his own. And he goes home and his parents don't believe him. They think he's died and he's wearing very fine clothes because he's the king of the Golden Mountain. And he cannot get them to see that it's him. And so it shows this real lack of repair. There was this profound wound that has not been repaired. And there's some things that happen where his wife now leaves him, abandons him, and he finally makes his way back, and she's about to marry someone else. And on his way back, he's acquired these magical objects, one of which is a sword that when you draw it and say, all heads off but mine, everyone in the room with you, their head comes off, but not yours. So it's this really kind of super aggressive image. And he goes back, he sees that she has betrayed him, much like his parents betrayed him. And a couple things happen, but he says all heads off but mine, and everyone dies. It's actually not clear at the end of the tale if his wife has died or not. And he's the king of the Golden Mountain again. It's one of the most unsatisfying endings in any of the Grimm fairy tales, because that's actually the end of the tale. And you're just like, wow, okay. But I think it sort of fits with the feeling that's in the fairy tale of this deep, deep wound that has left behind a lot of rage, and there's been no repair. There is no way of repairing. And there's just this kind of lashing out destructiveness.
That brings up one of the most heartbreaking realities, that not all trauma and symptomology can in fact be resolved, and that we enter into an analysis or therapy with hopes, but without certainty of the results. And sometimes a person simply living in their golden mountain is as good as it gets and might be good enough. And we have to accept our own limits and humanity, that there is a higher power that also has to step in to make things different. And that's a tale where that does not seem to happen.
Yeah, it seems to be a tale of how powerful what Kalsched calls the archetypal defenses of the self, how powerful they can be. And that this young man he's the king of the Golden Mountain. Reminds me of the tale of Midas, you know, that when everything he touched turned to gold, he could turn people into gold as well. Of that it's a static, lonely.
It's really defended.
defended world where everything has to be gold, it looks like it's golden.
Right. Then we are in a sort of a place that has like a schizoid feel, mm-hmm. aren't we?
And there we're back to the all or nothing construct again, that mm-hmm. everything is golden, except for I'm there all by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And that isolation, psychic isolation that comes in when we have cut off or dismembered parts of ourselves.
Well, I think this quietness that we're holding on to leaves us in this sober, quiet place. And maybe that's a time to shift to the dream.
Hi, this is Lisa from This Jungian Life podcast. Joseph, Deb, and I have been deeply moved by your responses to our work. Producing, editing, and distributing the podcast involves substantial expenses, and we need your help. Please stop by our website, thisjungianlife.com, and click on the heading, Be Our Patron. You'll be redirected to our Patreon funding page. Patreon helps creators connect with people who believe in projects like ours. There, you can sign up with your credit card to support us for as little as $1 a month, and at higher levels of support, we'll provide special episodes, behind-the-scenes photos and stories, and a chance to join a select pool of listeners for dream interpretations. Thank you. Okay, so this dream comes from a man who's 24 years old, and he's unemployed by choice right now. He's backpacking and just doing odd jobs. This is a dream that contains imagery of dismemberment, and that was not synchronicity this time. That was on purpose. So here we go. In this dream, I remember being in a building that reminded me of a hospital or perhaps an asylum. It was very clinical looking. Lots of steel and glass, white and silver walls, trim people in smocks or scrubs. I was walking up a small stairway and looked through a doorway to see blood and body parts on the ground in front of me. Somehow I knew that it was two separate bodies, but I do not know who they belonged to. When I saw the body parts, I was anxious and had to stop myself from passing out inside the dream because I had a feeling that whoever did that to the bodies could be nearby. As I gathered myself, I began to walk away from the bodies very calmly to avoid drawing attention to myself. As I walked away, I saw a man, probably in his 50s or 60s, also a stranger, carrying a silver platter with more body parts. As I passed him, he said hello and smiled as if nothing were out of the ordinary. I then ran out of the building and vaguely remember running through a maze that had been set up on a basketball court until I was outside the building in a small grass field. The building was made of brick and seemed to be in the middle of nowhere. It had that look that many academic buildings have on college campuses. And here's what he says for context. He says, I was having very vivid dreams where I recognized I was dreaming in each of them. This one stood out to me more than any other. These dreams all came in the days leading up to my participation in a ceremony which involved the use of traditional Peruvian plant medicine. The ceremony proved to be one of the most impactful experiences of my life. Said, what were the main feelings in the dream? The dreamer says he remembers feeling nauseous, completely overwhelmed, and very anxious. It was as if the entire world was falling apart and I needed to get away. And for some additional context, he says he was curious about the significance of the dismembered bodies.
So just one association I have. Has to do with shamanism. When you first read the dream, I had a really rather more pessimistic feeling about it. But knowing that he was anticipating a shamanic experience, and I would imagine had some education moving towards it about shamanic phenomena, then this became more interesting. So in shamanism, people are often working with animal totems, and the animals, the particular animal that's assigned to somebody, or discovers them, interacts with them in the imaginal worlds. And it is a fairly common experience that at some points, the power animal will dismember the shaman, eat them, ingest them, or do something else with their body parts, which is a deconstruction of the old subtle body and or the old psyche, which is leading to a coagulation, a reformation on a higher arc. So given that this is coming towards the ceremony, I don't know about this particular plant medicine, but I'm assuming that it's somewhat similar to psilocybin or peyote or ayahuasca. And these kinds of extremely intense visionary experiences really do cause a cutting open and a cutting apart of the old life.
Yeah,
that's in a way that's pretty powerful.
Yeah, that's a great amplification because, yes, it's pretty common for a shaman to be gnawed down to the bones, to be dismembered, to be cut up. I mean, very violent things happen to shamans during their experiences.
During their visions.
So it's interesting that in a way this is the flip side of dismemberment is that it's also the coming apart of the psychic body in order to have a remembering in a whole different way.
Mm-hmm.
It's a kind of a rebirth image.
That's certainly the shamanic sense of it, yes.
Mm-hmm. And worth considering in the context of this dream and in the context of the dreamer anticipating participation in this ceremony. And he says, it proved to be one of the most impactful experiences in my life. So it does sort of have the sense that psyche is anticipating
mm-hmm.
the coming apart mm-hmm. in order to come back together in a new way.
Mm-hmm.
And dreams are often bringing up something that we don't know. So I'm also imagining, just in a very reasonable way, that, you know, we find out about these transformational workshops and the plant medicine, we're all enthusiastic about it. It's all very idealized. And we're often not paying attention to the underlying anxiety and the psychological potential of these things. So the unconscious, just to make sure that he mm-hmm. knows what he's walking into, is delivers to him this very potent dismemberment image, which puts him in touch with his underlying anxiety,
mm-hmm.
which the unconscious wants him to carry if he chooses to move forward into
right,
this experience.
Like, this is a big deal.
This is a big deal, and you are anxious about it, and you have to kind of own that as part of the initiatic potential.
I'm going to go back right to the very beginning of the dream. That he is in a building that reminds him of a hospital or perhaps
or an asylum,
and was clinical looking with glass and steel walls, et cetera, people in scrubs. So it feels very sterile at first, doesn't it? And yet a hospital implies a place of healing.
Mm-hmm.
And asylum, of course, is supposed to be a safe place, but that has a lot of ambiguity around it, since asylums could also be places to warehouse people that were not fitting into society and who were called crazy.
And right now in the public discourse, the word asylum, you know, people, immigrants seeking asylum,
yes.
is really, it's a word that's vibrant in the public discourse.
Yes.
I'm aware. I'm with you, Deb, on being curious about the opening image. And I do want to say that the dream ends in a very different place, or at least a somewhat different place, that he's in a small grassy field and near a building that looks like it may be on a college campus. So we've gone from this very kind of clinical, soulless place to someplace that has some nature in it that feels a little bit warmer. And one of the things that I wonder about is this opening image of this hospital with steel and glass and all that. It perhaps is an image of a place where we might be overly trapped in our thinking function. You know, there, it's sort of a kind of hypertrophied, you know, rationality, let's say.
Yes.
And that this process of dismemberment might bring him to a place where there's more of a marriage between the kind of world of the right brain and the world of the left brain, and this kind of a grass field that's near a brick building. It's not the middle of the jungle. There's still kind of structure there, but there's more balance.
Yeah, and he's gone from a hospital or asylum to a building that looks like a lot of academic or college buildings. So from a place of healing to a place of learning,
mm-hmm.
perhaps. But I'm also really interested in this the difference between what he feels in the dream and what he feels after the dream, that he sees all these bodies, body parts on the ground. I mean, one might expect a dream ego to be going, oh my gosh, this is really horrible. But no, our dreamer just says, this is the way it was. I don't know who they belong to. Then he does say, I was anxious and had to stop myself from passing out in the dream because whoever did that to the bodies might be nearby. So there is the other feeling of horror.
Mm-hmm.
And then he sees a man in his 50s or 60s carrying a silver platter with more body parts. And as I passed him, he said hello and smiled as if nothing were out of the ordinary. So I'm aware of this tension between these dream figures that are kind of blasé about this and no big deal, and the dream ego that is starting to have some feelings about how horrible this is.
And also when I think about the man with the silver platter, you know, I have a couple of friends that are shamans and they, you know, participate in these psychotropic workshops. And there is a way in which they're walking around with this kind of benign smile on their face. And it's like, eat this basket of mushrooms. It'll be fine. You know, there's this very relaxed attitude, you know, and they're fine. So it's like the shaman is fine with the dismemberment, you know, but these people have no idea how enormous this experience is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
I also want to bring up the transitional sentence that he runs through a maze. And he successfully navigates a maze, and then he's returned to an academic environment. And is in a sense, there's a feeling of the ordinary being restored. So in order to navigate a maze successfully, you have to have a pretty good cognitive function.
Mm-hmm.
So what I think is, he's involved in this tremendous distress in the first part of the dream, and this fear even that perhaps he's going to be injured by the workshop, by this stuff, which is a sober reality. And then he has to return to this kind of cognitive, logical assessment, wake up his mind and his intellect to kind of get himself back on track and kind of, quote unquote, talk himself off the ledge and see if he can navigate himself forward in the way that the ego has decided.
Yeah, that's a good amplification. So it's something like putting ego to use in service to something larger. Like perhaps the too locked down image in the beginning is there's too much kind of ego consciousness, and then it's going to be dismembered. But there clearly exists in this dream the possibility that there can be this kind of what Jung called the relativization of the ego, where it's in relationship to these irrational factors in the psyche and can kind of be in service to them, guiding us through the maze to a place where there's a little more balance. I'm also wanting to lift up this image that I could tell there were two bodies, but I do not know who they belong to. So that's, you know, it's like these jumbled body parts. It's like something needs to be discriminated.
Yes, there's an opportunity to sort something out, but it's a little too frightening and gory to kind of do.
Yeah. And of course, you know, I can't read this dream without thinking of the fairy tale Bluebeard. This woman has married this man who's very wealthy and, you know, she thinks it's all great. She thinks it's all fine. It doesn't bother her at all that he has a blue beard. And so this is just a little note to our listeners that, you know, if you are ever considering dating anyone and his beard is blue, you might just want to give that another
thought. It's a red flag.
It's a red flag.
Blue beard, red flag.
But he tells her he's going to go away for a few days, and he gives her the key, and he says, you can go to any room in the palace except for this one. And of course, you know, what's the first thing she does when he leaves is go into that room, and it's filled with body parts of his previous wives. So there is a moment in the fairy tale where it's really waking up. It's, you know, it's like going back to our earlier topic. She had cut herself off from the reality of knowing that this man that she'd married was in fact a dangerous predator. She was cut off from that factor in her psyche, say. And there's when you open the door and you really look and you can really see what's there. So there's perhaps an echo of that in the dream too, of like, what's behind this really clinical, cold, pristine glass and steel world? Well, it's something pretty grim that we don't want to really take a look at very often, but the effect of looking at it can really be to wake us up.
Absolutely, it can mobilize. I also want to just come back to these visionary workshops, like ayahuasca workshops, and I've had opportunity to talk to people in great detail about the experiences. And when I hear them talk about the ayahuasca workshops, it sounds very, very much like Jung's Red Book. And so if we even imagine that the condition he's entering into the workshop is a condition of fragmentation, mm-hmm. which may be part of this kind of aimlessness, this unemployment, kind of being a wanderer in the world, perhaps. But there's something that's dismembered in the psyche. And often people in these ceremonies really do have an experience of being put back together, that the symbol-making function of the psyche comes forward in this roaring way. The figures are three-dimensional. They're talking. They have opinions. They make demands on the ego. And the inner world is extraordinarily populated, and the ego cannot run away from it. So there is this created confrontation with the unconscious that, just as it was for Jung, is often deeply healing.
See, if I had to make a guess about this dreamer, and of course I'm just guessing here, but I, again, I'm sort of struck by this initial image of this very clinical looking building, that it's possible that this dreamer has been used to living his life in this way that's, you know, very kind of defended and in his head, as it were. And the healing factor would be, as you said, Joseph, kind of confronting the inner world.
I'm going to the part in the notes where he says he's curious about the significance of dismembered bodies, which I hope we have addressed in this whole episode. Okay, and then he says, when I did my own research, I stumbled upon something Jung called conjunctio. However, I could not find a solid definition of what this is or what it refers to. So I'm thinking about this remembering and this traditional Peruvian ceremony and what can happen, and whether that is what he was looking for. Is conjunctio is the coming together, the union of the opposites, that might be the answer, in a sense, at least for the time being, to that, what you've pointed out, Lisa, this jumble of body parts, as it was in Bluebeard, the fairy tale, of just, I don't know what this all is. Mm-hmm. So it hasn't been consciously discriminated, but there is some kind of underlying meaning of a waking up, as there was in Bluebeard, a coming into consciousness of that somehow things have come together in the unconscious, and there will be more growth and development, I think, as there is for all of us subsequent to this. But that he was looking for an experience of conjunctio, of some kind of wholeness.
And it seems like, from what he shared with us, that he might have found it.
Yes, and that he wanted to be companion on the journey. I mean, he could have probably bought up, 5 grams of mushrooms and just taken them and seen what happened. But some instinct inside of him said he wanted to have this in a ritualized, sanctified, or consecrated environment with a companion that kind of could guide him or help him hold this deconstructing experience, and that willingness to make this sacred and to allow someone to be close to him while this is happening, again, is very positive, very hopeful.
You've been listening to This Jungian Life. From our website, thisjungianlife.com, you can follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, help us produce future episodes by funding us through Patreon, and submit your dreams for possible interpretation on another episode. We'd like to thank our listener who shared a dream for today's show, and hope you'll let us know what topics you'd enjoy hearing more about. Until next time, keep living this Jungian life.